Throughout the world, it's common in forested areas that people have developed some sort of forest class ecosystem or some sort of ecosystem classification system. And the idea with that is when you come up with an understanding of the ecology and best management practices for a certain type of ecosystem, then if you find the same or a similar forest ecosystem elsewhere, you can apply those same practices. So it's a very useful framework for thinking about how to manage forests, whether you're managing them for timber or wildlife or ecosystem services or so forth. British Columbia has a really, really wide range of forested ecosystems. We go from temperate rainforests all the way to grasslands that are near deserts. And we have a tremendous range of, aside from climate, we also have a tremendous range of elevation, of latitude. So we have very different light. We have different parent materials in different areas. And so in order to figure out how to manage these forests, in the 1960s and 70s, the Biogeoclimatic Ecosystem Classification System was developed. So this was developed for British Columbia, specific to British Columbia, though it has its roots in other systems, especially of habitat classification systems that have come out of Eastern Europe, focused on the identification of understory plants and using that as the key for determining which types of ecosystem you're in. Regardless of the ecosystem classification system used, all of these systems rely on the same underlying principles. We have some range of ecological variability in species, in disturbance, in soils, and what we want to try to do is take a very large, very continuous range of conditions and try to kind of break it up into chunks of similar characteristics that we can kind of treat as a unit. So it's a little bit artificial. We're taking things that are very gradual and change gradually over space and trying to kind of fit them into bins. So there's limitations, especially when you're at the boundaries between those bins or the boundary between two ecosystem types, but it's still a really useful idea on the whole. These classification systems always have some sort of a hierarchy, some sort of different levels of classification, where you start with very broad categories and then those get further and further subdivided into more detailed classifications until you get to the finest level, some sort of ecosystem level that's going to be based on specific vegetation, specific plants, specific types of soils, so specific types of soil moisture regimes and soil nutrient regimes in an area. At the top level of that scale, we're mostly looking at areas that have similar climate. In BC, the top level of this system, we call that zones. So British Columbia has 16 BEC zones. These zones are areas that have broadly similar climate, broadly similar soil parent material, and they have the same climatic climax tree species or group of tree species. And in BC, we name these zones based on their climatic climax tree species. And what that means is if you were to have a forest develop and go through the different stages of succession, if you didn't have a stand initiating disturbance and the forest was allowed to mature for a very long time without significant disturbance, what species of trees would you have growing at the end of that stage? That's the climatic climax species. So here I'm standing in a coastal western hemlock forest. So western hemlock, or coastal western hemlock is the zone, CWH, and western hemlock is the climatic climax species. So if we were to come back to this forest that I'm standing in here right now in 200 years and there hadn't been significant disturbance and probably hadn't been a lot of climate change, because that's obviously going to come into play too, then we would expect that western hemlock would be one of the dominant trees in the canopy. In this particular zone, there's some other species too that might stick around for that length of time. I'll talk about that in a separate video. Below zones, we have subzones. So subzones are finer gradations, kind of finer splits in climate. And we name those based on precipitation regime and continentality if it's a coastal zone. So here in the coastal western hemlock zone, this is a coastal zone. And I'm actually here in the very dry maritime subzone. So very dry relates to the precipitation regime, and maritime relates to continentality. On the coast, we're looking at how continental a subzone is, and that just means how strongly is the temperature influenced by the ocean. And the three categories are hypermaritime, meaning extremely influenced by the ocean, maritime, which is just strongly influenced by the ocean, and submaritime, which is somewhat influenced by the ocean. The more maritime a climate is, the more the ocean moderates the changes in temperature. So in a hypermaritime climate, typically your summers are relatively cool and your winters are not especially cold. So the difference between summer and winter temperatures isn't so great. And likewise, during a day, your high temperature in that temperature given during a day will likely not be that different than a low temperature during the day. And as you move farther away from the ocean and have less ocean influence, your summer temperatures are going to get hotter, your winter temperatures are going to get colder. So this we would call this a more continental climate in comparison to maritime. And likewise, you have more temperature fluctuation in a day too. So your daily high temperatures will be higher and your daily low temperatures will be lower as you have less influence from the ocean. In the interior BEC zones, instead of talking about continentality, we should just give a temperature regime. And there's several different levels of that. So that's how we name a subzone. And then within each subzone, we further subdivide those categories into site series. And site series is based on surface characteristics of the area, microtopography, slope position, aspect, things like that, and soil. And all together, those influence the kind of microsite conditions. And what we're especially interested in there is how the soil nutrient availability and soil moisture availability changes. So depending on slope position, depending on aspect, depending on soil characteristics, one site may have more water available to plants than another site that's relatively close. Or the soil might be a bit finer textured, a bit more fertile, maybe there's more organic matter, more clay particles. And so even on a small scale, just over a scale of hundreds of meters or kilometers, we'll have variation in those conditions. And that's how we classify to site series. And site series is the finest level of classification in the BEC system. And that's generally our goal when we're trying to classify an area. We're trying to figure out what the site series is, because that will tell us very detailed information about the conditions in that location. And management prescriptions have already been developed at the level of site series. So we can look at a reference manual and find suggestions about harvesting regimes, silvicultural systems that might work, what types of tree species could be planted there and in what mix, and so forth. So that's really the level that we're trying to get at for a management perspective. And this BEC system was developed with timber in mind, and it was developed several decades ago when we had a slightly different understanding of the ecology of forests. So it's not a perfect system. It has some shortcomings, but it does a pretty good job, particularly thinking for timber management. But this classification system can also be used for thinking about more ecological objectives like wildlife habitat management or protection of rare ecosystems.